Let's get started on movement. What's up? I'm Jonathan, and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about precision movement in Blender. First, we're going to understand what Blender movement is like within object and edit mode, and then we're going to understand how to do precision movement easily within Blender. Once again, starting on a fresh new Blender file, let's go ahead and do movement. There's going to be the fundamentals of movement, also some advanced movement in Blender, and my favorite type of movement, which is CAD transforms movement. Now, I am going to be doing something a little bit different. This whole topic is going to be split up into three videos, as it's a mammoth topic. We're going to be exploring it in object mode, in edit mode, and then using CAD transforms in both object and edit mode. So let's go ahead and let's dive straight into object mode. So we're going to select everything, we're going to delete it, and then we're going to create our own cube that is going to be exactly 1 millimeter. Okay, now that we have a size reference here, let's go ahead and move our origin point to this vertex here. I'm sure you can remember this from the last video. So we're going to go vertex snapping using our 3D cursor, snap it down there, right click, set origin, origin to 3D cursor. And this here is the first type of movement. If we hit N, we open our menu here. We could also just toggle it back and forth there. And here you can see we have our location, rotation, scale, and dimensions. Let's go from the top down. So location, let's just click, drag down, and that lets you select everything, and let's put in 0. And that there is how we do some exact placement. So we can go on the Y, we can hit 1 and it moves it 1 on the Y. We can go on the X and put in -0.8 and it moves it -0.8 on the X axis. Brilliant. So we also have rotation, and as you can gather, that's exactly what it's going to do. As you've realized, it's using the origin point as the pivot point. And the origin is going to be the origin for movement, for rotation, for scale, you name it, it's all of it. Anyway, let's put this back to 0 now, and let's bring it back to 0. Let's talk about scale and dimensions for a moment. So yes, I'm not saying you can't change scale, and I'm not saying you can't use the dimensions here. I'm just saying be aware of what I'm about to say. Blender wants your objects to be at one scale, because in the future we are going to be using something called modifiers. And modifiers are incredibly powerful, but they are very sensitive to scale. They're sensitive to a few other things, but we'll cover those later on. So let's say we wanted this cube to be a 3 by 1.5. Brilliant. Now our scale is broken. How do we fix this? Well, to do that, we need to apply the scale to our object. And what we're doing is going to go Control A. This brings up our apply menu, and then let's hit scale. Don't apply all transforms and the rest, because that's going to put you in a real muddle later on. So let's just go ahead and put it for scale, and you'll see that our scale is now down to 1. And our dimensions have stayed. Okay, let's go ahead and let's put all these dimensions back to 1. And then here, let's apply our scale once again. Okay, for all of those of you that are wondering, okay, where's all these shortcuts coming from? I'm never going to learn them. They're going to be down in the description. I'm working on a very clear way of showing all the shortcuts. Plus, remember that everything here that I'm talking about is going to be in these menus. There's nothing that's hidden. It's all there, and it's very easy. And you also have the space bar that we set up right at the beginning to be your search menu. So if you wanted, you could go ahead and put in scale, and then you'll find scale, apply. Brilliant. There it is. Just be aware, it's all there for you. Okay, so that there is how to use the transform menu. Let me show you the tools then. I'm sure you've seen them on the left-hand side here. We have our move tool, rotate tool, our scale tool, and transform tool. So let's click our cube. Let's hit our move tool, and it brings up this lovely little gizmo. It's very self-explanatory. We have the axis constraints, plane constraints. You can click an axis, put in a number, and that's it, done. Brilliant. So let's set that all back to zero for now. Let's do the same for rotation. Rotation, we have our rotation here, we have our rotation there, and we can put in a number, 45, and that's it, done. Okay, now you might see this white ring. The outer white ring is for viewport style movement. So if you wanted to move along your viewport looking angle, that's where this is going to happen. And that is the same for movement as well. You have this free move here that's going to move it sort of perpendicular to your viewport, but it can be a little bit haphazard as well. So just be aware of that. And now we have scale. Scale's a little bit different again. Yes, we have our plane. We have this plane here too, and we have our axis scaling perfect. Okay, but scale has something a little bit different. Over here, it's a drop down, and we have something called the scale cage. Just be wary if you're going to be using the scale cage, because the scale cage moves the origin point with the scaling. So that can be quite counterintuitive when it comes to scaling and depending where you're scaling from. Because where you're scaling, your origin point is going to no longer be as concrete as you might be expecting for precision modeling. Okay, now we've looked at all the tools. The transform is just all of them at once, and just be accurate where you're clicking. Now I want to pose a question. First, this is a lot of clicking for these. And second is, when we have a rotation, let's say we went here and put in 45 degrees and I want to go in that direction, how do I do that? Well, first let's cover the shortcuts. The shortcuts, because this is Blender, are needed because that's how we do an efficient workflow. So we're going to move an object, and that's by grabbing it, and we're going to do that with G. You grab an object to move, and we can constrain that on the Y, on the X, and the Z, just like normal. We can go Y, 5, and it's exactly like the duplication movement that we've been working with. Now, rotating is the same. Again, it's using the pivot point. Keep that in mind always. And let's go ahead and put a 45 on that. And now we have our scaling. Let's plot this back to our normal scaling. And let's do an S for scale. And you can see we have our scaling here. We can also do constrained scales on the Y and on the X and on the Z. Okay, brilliant. Now, I'm wanting to move this in that direction. How do I do that? I'm just going to do our shortcut W to bring the selection box. And I want you to be aware of something. When we're moving, we are moving on something called the global axis. As you can see, the big green line is the global y-axis, and this is the global x-axis, and we have the global z-axis. If you ever want to bring up the z-axis, you can go over here to your overlays and show it right there, but there's no need to. Okay, so why are you telling me about this global? Well, this object has been rotated 45 degrees. So if it had a little smiley face right here, it's facing this way. So that means that locally for the cube, the Y should be in that direction. And that's exactly it. We have a local axis here on our transform orientations. And if we click local there, and now we were go to our move tool, you can see that it's moved in that direction. Now, if we go global, it snaps to the global. Okay, so shortcut wise, how does that look? So if we go, let's go W, then let's go G. If we go Y, okay, it's still on the Y. Okay, so let's go here and put local. If we go back, go G, and we go Y, it's moving on the Y direction. But now wanting to go back to the global, how do I do that? I can't click that right now. Well, there's actually a very easy way. There's no need to go up here and keep changing this. I work just in the global, and to do this, we're going to click our cube, we're going to hit G to move it, we're going to hit Y once, and now to move it into its local, we hit Y once again. And now it's in its local constraint. If you hit Y once again, it's going to be free floating again. It's just sort of cancelled the constraints. So we can do the same for the X. We can hit X once again, and it's going to move on its own X-axis. And this is completely the same no matter how you have your orientation. So if we were to put in another rotation here on its X-axis, oh, wait one second, that's not the X-axis that I'm talking about. I want to move on its own X-axis. By just going on its own local X-axis, we can go 45 degrees, and now we can move in a 45 degree angle upwards by going G, Y, Y, and there we have it. That is how to use Blender's default constraints. Okay, so with that now set, let's set everything back to zero here so we can explore some more things. Now that we have a grasp on all of our tools, let's go ahead and look into one other menu. So another menu that's used a lot with movement is this one right here, which is the Transform Pivot Point. Now, it can sound a bit weird, but there are multiple pivot points within Blender. Yes, objects have their own designated pivot point. But if we were to duplicate this and constrain it on the Y, and let's move it by 2 millimeters, and now we were to go ahead and select both of these, they both have origin points, but what's going to happen now when I do a rotation? Oh, okay, that's a little bit counterintuitive. How am I going to do a perfect rotation here? That doesn't quite make sense. Well, that's where this menu comes in. It comes in when you have multiple things selected. So if we were to go active elements, well, we now know that this is our active element. So if we did a rotation now, it's going to use the pivot point of the active element to influence the whole selection. Okay, great. So we've understood that. So what's going on with this individual origins then? Like, does that mean every single origin they will affect? That's basically it. You can use the origin point wherever it is on other objects to influence its own object. And that there is how to do that. Okay, let's take a look at one other one here. We have the 3D cursor. You can use the 3D cursor as another point. Yes, you can. In fact, what we can go ahead and do is let's go ahead and move our 3D cursor to, I don't know, let's say, let's go into our view here of the 3D cursor. Let's set its location to 0, its rotation to 0, and now let's set its Z-axis here to, yeah, let's say 2. So now with our 3D cursor selected, it's going to ignore those origin points and use the 3D cursor as the origin point. So as you can see, the origin point is a very powerful tool within Blender that can be defined in many different ways. Okay, lastly, I want to cover a little something extra, which doesn't really have to do with precision modeling, but it has to do with Blender. So let's go ahead, let's create a cube, and we're just going to be creating a matrix of cubes here. I'm not going to show you a quick way of doing this. I just want you to play around here and make yourself a whole bunch of cubes. Feel free to do what I'm doing here, but I very much want you to feel comfortable duplicating, constraining, using the move tool here to really be able to create what I'm creating right here. So all I'm doing is duplicating, constraining, putting a numerical input, and then just hitting enter. So duplicate, constrain, numerical, and now I want to duplicate this last row right here. Shift D, X to there. Okay, now why have I done this? It's because I want to show you a cool little thing that Blender has, which is called proportional editing. Now, we have almost covered everything up here. What's left is this one here. Proportional editing is not precision-based in the slightest, but it is definitely fun to play with. So I'm going to go ahead and set this to medium point, and now when we turn on proportional editing with this right there, and we go ahead and do a G to grab and move, you can see there's this circle that's appeared. So let's constrain this on the Z, and now if you scroll upwards, downwards, upwards, just scroll, you will see that this creates a proportional editing field around the object that you have. So this is a very fun thing to do within Blender, to really be able to create some incredibly interesting shapes. And yes, this does work over in edit mode, which I'm sure I'll cover later on when we're covering movement within edit mode. But I just wanted to show you all the types of movement that we have here that is default Blender movement before we go into anything else. And of course, to turn off proportional editing, just click this again, and that is now proportional editing turned off. Well done through getting that crazy video. Yes, it's probably one of the trickier ones so far, but it's one of the crucial ingredients when it comes to modeling within Blender, and even more so for precision modeling. If you want a little extra, stick to the end. A huge thank you to my patrons. You guys are absolutely awesome, and it's the real reason I can do things like this. And if you're enjoying what I'm doing here and think that I'm worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Don't forget that we do have a Discord down in the description. Thank you for watching, keep making, and let the quest continue. Down in the description is this Movement Object Obstacle course to make sure you really understand all the principles that we've just covered. Some of these will be quite tricky, so there is also a solution video down in the description.